By early afternoon, anyone who was fortunate enough to see what happened was something not long forgotten. The entire Yankee right flank melted like butter on a griddle.
The Rebs pushed away every brigade we had near the gap. Brannan's men were turned completely to the right, and Sheridan's and Davis's fine troops, which we supported, were soon routed between the Dyer and Tanyard buildings. Men were panic-stricken, and when asked where they would stop and reform, said, "The Ohio River." Our Spencer repeating rifles, once again, were called to save the line. Wilder's men went in and gave the Rebs lightning on their left flank, slowing them down.
Kneel down!
Oh,
found out from prisoners we escorted to the rear. General Rosecrans himself flew from the field on a fast horse, cut off from the second half of his army. Longstreet had done it. He had sent the Yankees packing, but we had seen this before. The men wanted to push and bag the whole Federal Army and end this war. About this time, General Forrest was ordered to push his men to the Lafayette Road to block the passage of the Yankee reinforcements coming to the rescue. They bullied our men from the road and meant business.
Our men retreated towards McFarland's Gap and the direction of Rossville. Half of the army remained on the field under the able leadership of General George H. Thomas, who organized a hilltop defense on the Snodgrass Farm and ridge beyond. He had gathered Steedman's division, which had pushed their way down past Forrest Cavalry, and Brannan's diehards, and the men of Wood's division. Units were rallying and praising Thomas's name once they realized he held off Longstreet.
Thank you.
No man could count how many times Longstreet's men went up and down those slopes, only to be swept back by artillery canister and well-timed musketry. We could tell Longstreet's men by their new uniforms. Mostly an off-blue color and their square flags. And our Army veterans by their homespun brown uniforms. But they fell in heaps, side by side. One man from Longstreet's Eastern Army was a man called the Angel of Fredericksburg, or something like that. An officer named Kirkland from South Carolina was known for his care of Yankee wounded the previous year. Darkness was then approaching, and then exhausted men of both sides wondered if there would be a third day of battle.
Thomas kept his men on the field with the assistance of Granger's Reserve Corps. By 7:30 or 8 o'clock, most of his men were brought away from the broken-down property of Snodgrass Hill. Some regiments were assigned to hold off all the Rebs and were wrecked and captured. The boys of Old Rosie's Army were broken down physically, mentally, and just wanted to get away from Bragg. The affair at Chickamauga was a sure enough defeat.
The following morning of the 21st, General Forrest pushed north in the direction of Lookout Mountain and watched the Yankees make for Chattanooga. General Bragg was begged to aggressively pursue the Yankees, but Bragg got his feet caught in mud. The whole of them could have been bagged. Bragg allowed the Yankees to occupy the city, get rest, and settle for a siege. The victory at Chickamauga was not a shining victory, but a dull blood crimson victory. The war was just allowed to go on until the fall, and more death. Both armies were becoming perfect at killing each other without ending the war. As we watched the Yankees in Chattanooga, we knew they gained strength while we weakened What would Bragg lead us to next?